Trucks are big business in America, so it's time to announce our 2024 Auto Buyer's Guide Truck of the Year Award winner. And before we get into that, though, we should talk about the four contestants, because I think we did have four solid entries. Let's run through the four entries and talk about why or why not they were our top picks. So, Travis, which were the four finalists?
Well, like you said, it's a big market in the United States, and I'll just go from biggest to smallest just to simplify things. At the very top of that list, we had the Ford Super Duty line. We included a few in that line, but the Ford Super Duty was there as our largest. Next, coming down in the full-size truck, we have the GMC Sierra. Then we have the Toyota Tacoma, the new 2024 refresh. And then we have, at the very bottom, our smallest entrant, the Ford Maverick.
Yep, it's absolutely adorable. Let's go through in order, I guess, from smallest or largest to smallest, and we'll talk about why they didn't win here. So the Ford Super Duty obviously has some truly bonkers, fantastic numbers. You can get, I mean, keep in mind that 30 years ago, it would have required multiple vehicles to give you this much total horsepower and torque. You can get up to 500 horsepower, 1,200 pound-feet of torque in just one truck from one engine. And you can get it with a warranty and a transmission that's not going to shatter itself the moment you connect a trailer to it. Those are some truly astonishing numbers. 40,000 pounds of towing capability, etc. 8,000 pounds of payload. For me, what I think kept it from the list is obviously it's relatively narrow audience. The vast majority of trucks sold are not 3/4 ton or 1 ton trucks. So there's a bit of a limited market there. The other thing for me is the interior. I really wish that Ford would get outside their comfort zone a little bit with the interiors in their full-size trucks. We have recently seen the 2024 F-150. And I don't know about you, Travis, but I don't think that interior really stepped up the game too far.
I don't think so either. I do think it was a tweak versus a revamp. And I think just in general, like you mentioned, the vast majority of trucks purchased are not in that 3,500, 4,500 and up category. So I do think putting the Ford Super Duty on our finalist list is a nod to the impressive numbers and capability of it. But it isn't going to win this just because it didn't really blow us away. And even if it did, it'd have to be a substantial margin to do so, because, again, there's just not going to be that many on the road.
Mm-hmm. But I will say, best heavy-duty truck available in North America right now. I'd buy it over the Ram. I think I might just by a hair buy it over the GMC Sierra 2500 or 3500 as well. But speaking of the Sierra, our next one up is the Sierra 1500. And it misses the top spot for actually kind of a similar reason. Because even though it does have the fantastic new interior, which is the reason that it's on this list, and so many different configuration options, you have to get the SLE trim in order to get that new interior. So if you get the other trims, then you actually get the older last generation interior. And same thing happens on the Chevy Silverado. So for the new interior, minimum point of entry is right around $46,000. So it is a pretty decent bump over the advertised low MSRP on that model. And there is no way to get the new interior on a regular cab long bed version of the GMC Sierra, which I find kind of sad there. What are your thoughts on the Sierra and Silverado lineup right now?
Yeah, I mean, between the two, I think they've done a better job this year and with some of these changes at differentiating the two. It is nice to have a lot of different cab and bed configurations. You know, again, the truck buyer is a pretty wide group looking for different things out of their vehicle. The Sierra is here because of that attractive new interior. As far as all the features and putting them all together, we're still not quite where I think we'd like to be as far as getting to pick each and every piece. That is one of the benefits and also one of the challenges of configuring your full-size truck is there's a million ways to do it.
Yes,
and some manufacturers are stepping that down and trying to simplify it. And they've been more or less successful. The other thing we liked about that Sierra is that new diesel engine. Again, those are things that you do have to pay a little bit more for, not necessarily standard. But again, as far as engine options go, the Sierra has quite a few.
Yep. And that's why it's certainly on this list. I should say we haven't seen the refreshed Ram 1500. The Ram 1500 realistically wasn't eligible because the current model is ending. And we're going to have to wait till 2024 to actually drive it. So maybe it'll be on the list next year with its updated interior and its updated drivetrain. And of course, we haven't driven the 2024 F-150 either. But again, it's more of a modest change, not a huge earth-shattering change. It just has some new barn doors in the back. That brings us along to the new Toyota Tacoma. I'm giving away the end of the video here, I guess. But the Tacoma, I think, is absolutely fantastic. But it didn't make it for me on this list because we don't see the entire Tacoma portfolio just yet. And I really want to sample the new hybrid drivetrain before I give all of Tacoma an award. That's just me personally.
Yeah, there's, you know, the Tacoma has been the number one selling midsize truck for quite some time. And it has a growing audience. And I think they've done their very best in this iteration to meet those audiences where they're at. You know, it is one of the few trucks we see with an extended cab. In this case, they call it the extra cab, not the access cab, which is sort of a plus and a minus as far as our scoring goes. But you do have different bed options. You do get to keep the option of a manual transmission, which is great. And you can do that in a couple different configurations. But we haven't seen kind of the top dog. And one of the things that made the Tacoma so popular was always that TRD Pro. Here's the do everything, go everywhere truck. And even if you didn't buy the Pro, it's one of the reasons that you look at the Tacoma, because this is the one everyone was talking about. So we haven't seen the Pro. With its big new feature is the seats, which looks interesting. I really want to try it out and see how big of a difference that feels, because it's the first time we've seen that tech in the midsize truck category for sure. And then the Trail Hunter, which is the big overland, which is an incredibly fast paced growing segment, people wanting to overland their trucks. And this is the from Toyota factory line overland trim. But there's also that powertrain. So not just these features, but this new powertrain. And as they've already switched to turbocharged, what does this hybrid look like? And is it hopefully a continued improvement, or would we be a little bit disappointed? So sort of a reserving judgment. There's a lot of things to make decisions on here.
Yeah. And I will say that the price tag is part of the reason why I was a little bit, looking sideways at it a bit here, because it's going to start at $32,995. Which is a pretty healthy jump over 2023 pricing. And that is for the SR two-seat rear-wheel drive vehicle. Yes, I did say two-seat. So it starts as a two-seat truck. You can get the bigger cab for five seats if you want. But as Travis said, there's no small cab with the suicide doors and tiny back seats or anything. That's just not an option in the Tacoma
on that base
anymore.
Truck. Yeah. On that base truck, you get the detuned engine. And so that's just kind of another hit. If it was not detuned for that price, it would definitely feel like a better value.
I think it might be a little bit better value, but like GM does the same thing with the detuning in Colorado and Canyon. I will say that, you know, by the time you've added the four-door cab, which you'll find standard in the GM, the Ford, the Jeep, and the Honda trucks in this segment, the time you've added that four-door cab and you get the more powerful engine, so the horsepower is comparable to, say, the base engine in the Frontier for performance-wise, you are definitely looking at around $36,000 to $37,000. So it's a pretty significant jump for a lot of folks up there in terms of price. And that takes us along to the absolutely adorable Maverick Hybrid, which I think has surprised pretty much everybody as far as its sales performance. And that would be the only ding against this in my book is, good luck actually getting a Maverick Hybrid.
And as far as the sales performance, it's not just initial, but it's continued performance. We did mention it in our previous video, but the thing we've seen with the Maverick that we didn't really expect was that they've switched out the base engine and made that hybrid option the option, and you have to pay more for it now instead of the standard, which has not been popular with a lot of folks, but it hasn't really stopped anyone from moving forward with it either, just because of how compelling it is to have a... we'll call it a more reasonably sized truck, because this is not a small truck. It's not a small vehicle, but it's the smallest you can get for running around town. Four doors, five seats that you can fit people in, and a bed that may not hold everything with the tailgate up, but you throw it down and most of your stuff will fit. And at 40 miles per gallon, it's hard to argue this isn't a phenomenal vehicle.
Yeah, the interesting thing that's always struck me about the truck market in a way is that when you stand back and you look at the truck market holistically in the U.S. over the last 30 years, Sales really started booming in the truck segment when they added four doors, and four real doors, I mean. When we first saw that move outside of, because International had had some real four-door trucks way, 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 way back. But the big three, when they started doing real honest-to-goodness half-ton four-door trucks, sales just absolutely started exploding across the truck lineup. That's also kind of when we started seeing the smaller trucks in America going, well, hey, maybe we should just have four doors and a even shorter bed behind, etc. The reality is that trucks have become not just cargo haulers and toy haulers. They've become family vehicles. And so you need that four-door capacity. And it kind of makes sense that we now have basically a truck-shaped version of a Ford Escape, I guess you could say, or even a Ford Focus, depending on how you want to consider the positioning of the Maverick. As people move away from sedans and move away from hatchbacks into trucks and SUVs, this is that sort of do-anything, go-anywhere thing that the original RAV4 and CR-V and Ford Escape were when they came out, and they really started rocking the world with an explosion in crossover sales in the U.S. I think this is going to be doing the same sort of thing for, in a way, more practical small trucks, because we do have that usable outside cargo area in the back. And hopefully this spurs some competition from the others.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at it right now, we have the Hyundai Santa Cruz, which is definitely not the same, but it falls in a similar category, truck-like, without being a heavy-duty, light-duty truck. And you look at what the Maverick did, which is kind of challenge the status quo. Again, the status quo is set by its own parent company, Ford. But if you look at the trucks that have tried to be a little bit disruptive, you've seen mixed results. The Honda Ridgeline, when it first hit the market, was very much an unusual truck. And again, there's still debate, is it a truck? My answer is yes. But you've seen the Maverick be a lot more successful than that original Ridgeline was. And then when you look at kind of one of the funkier trucks, you have like the Explorer Sport Track, which is actually sort of what this reminds me of, very different capabilities, but size and shape and proportion. But then it's also been a lot more successful than something like the Subaru Baja, which is, again, just kind of a lifestyle vehicle with the bed. And so, you know, hats off to the Ford Maverick. I love its price point. I love its utility. I love the efficiency that you get from it. As long as you know front wheel drive works for you. And spoiler alert, if it snows, front wheel drive is a great option. So that's why it's make the top of our list here.
Yep. And I will say that I think that the reason, if I want to pontificate for a bit, the reason I think that this has succeeded where other trucks have failed is the Ridgeline looks an awful lot like a Honda Pilot. And it shares the interior with the Pilot. They didn't try and redesign the interior to make it look more trucky. And Honda's never built trucks really before for the North American market. Ford has a lot of experience building trucks. So they decided when they created the Maverick that they needed to pull down a lot of the core features from the F-150. And I think they did it to really great effect. Thinking about how the tailgate can function in different stage levels, that we could support loads that are maybe on top of the wheel wells versus not on top of the wheel wells, et cetera, so that we can get those 4x8 sheet goods in the vehicle relatively easily. How you can tie that cargo down. And then they wrapped it in a package that's attractive. So they didn't just take the Ford Escape's nose and jam on a cargo bed, because that would have looked weird. But that is essentially what we find in the Santa Cruz and we find in the Ridgeline as well. They basically grafted a bed onto something existing. And I think that the combination of the boxy good looks and that practicality really worked for the Ford Maverick. And then there's the price tag. If this had been more expensive, I think it would not have worked. But they actually did put enough distance between it and the Ranger and the F-150 for it to really make sense. And then that 40-mile-per-gallon hybrid system took even Ford by surprise. And this is one of those things that I find the most amusing in a way, is that at the launch event, I've said this before in videos if anybody remembers, but at the launch event, Ford swore up and down that they needed to make the hybrid system standard so that way they could get the hybrid volume out there to meet fuel economy targets, and that they didn't think that anybody was really interested in it. They thought that, well, you know, it'll be kind of the loss leader. We'll sell a few. It'll help us make up our numbers. Everybody's going to want this turbo thing because truck owners want towing capability. They want this, they want that. And actually what it turns out the truck owners want, or truck intenders, because maybe we don't know exactly how many people are coming out of other trucks, but certainly people that are buying the Maverick, they have said time and time again, what they really want is 40 miles per gallon.
Yeah. I mean, with one thing you can't do with a traditional vehicle is overstuff it, right? There's literally a roof that limits what you can do with it. And when you look at something like the Maverick, that's got a wide open bed, sky's almost literally the limit. And so we like that flexibility. And so when you get four doors, five seats, a fun, funky look, that's not too funky. It's just, it's playful. It feels like to me. And then the truck that can match it, you can load whatever lifestyle, you know, tents and bikes and kayaks and whatever else on there. It was bound to be a hit, and luckily it's landed.
Yep. And so let us know if you've been in the market for a Maverick or a Maverick hybrid. Let us know if you think something else should have won down there in the comment section below. I will say that in preparation for recording this, I went on Ford's website and tried to do an inventory search, and I did find 67 Maverick hybrids in the San Francisco Bay Area. Now, that is not a lot. There were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of F-150s. But it does mean that supplies are finally starting to trickle in. Ford keeps ramping up production of the Maverick, and specifically ramping up production of the Maverick Hybrid. So I know some folks out there that have had pre-orders in for a very specific build of Maverick Hybrid have finally been able to get theirs. And so it seems like the pipeline is finally getting unstuck. And I will say that if it wasn't looking like it was getting unstuck, we probably would not have had it as our winner, because availability is definitely an important component here. So let us know all that down there below, and stay tuned for the rest of our Vehicle of the Year series. That'll be coming up over the next day or two. See all of you later.